This video was made possible through the support of my patrons.
We need to get out of here.
Have they gone?
Hello ladies and gentlemen, my name is Mr. TARDIS. Now, in Series 11, writer Pete Mattig made an impression writing that story. You know the one, Kablam. A story that seemed to start off as a fun satire and a critique of Amazon and its human rights abuses against its workers. However, when its third act rolled around, it turned out that the story was meant to be a condemnation of the workers asking for basic human decency, and that wanting better working conditions was akin to terrorism. And that's certainly a take. Remember, the story ended with Kablam suspending operations for a month pending review, and all of the workers getting 2 weeks paid leave. That's not a month! And that's a shame, because Kablam has really fun dialogue, memorable characters, and death by bubble wrap will go down as one of the most inventive fates in the revived series. Now, Mattig is back, co-writing a script with showrunner Chris Chibnall with Praxeus, which picks up where the last episode left off, with numerous deaths occurring on different continents. Ryan goes to Peru, where he meets vlogger Gabriella, whose friend has gone missing. Yaz and Graham go to Hong Kong and meet ex-police officer Jake, who is looking for his missing husband, and the doctor is in Madagascar, where she finds an infected man washed up on the shore and gets help from medical researchers Suki and Aramu. This is a decent setup, outside of the random discrepancy of the doctor sending Ryan, the guy with dyspraxia and confidence issues, on his own, but pairs Yaz, the trained police officer, with Graham.
Whatever is giving off those weird readings is on the other side of that wall. Is on the other side of this door.
Okay, now I see why Graham was paired up with someone.
Feel the lamp on my buns.
Anyway, aside from the random distribution in this flat team structure, the episode does a good job at giving the companions a lot to do. It's easily the first time since probably It Takes You Away where the companions all feel like they've contributed something, mainly because they all share the burden of acting as ciphers for the supporting cast as opposed to it just being Yaz. And that cast is big, but it's not overwhelming like Orphan 55, mainly because of how they start off spread across the continents. The globe-hopping elements of the story might have lost its impact this season after the opening Spyfall, but it still works as an engaging hook. Though I do get the sense that with this, and also the numerous locations in Resolution and Spyfall, that Chris Chibnall just has a massive world map on his office wall, and before he writes any sort of treatment for his scripts, he just throws three darts at that map.
A missing submarine, a dead naval officer off the coast of Madagascar, birds going haywire in Peru, and active alien tech in Hong Kong. There's also a talking cat in Ontario, but I've ruled him out for now.
So, some sort of alien virus is taking over humans and killing them. The death effect is gruesome as well. The actors, even though they're only on screen for about 1 minute, absolutely sell the pain and the agony that they're in. Death by Praxeus looks like a really bad time.
No. What's on his hand?
Nasty way to go.
So it turns out that Praxeus is drawn to the microplastics on Earth, basically the tiny microscopic remnants of plastic which can't fully break down, and as a result, all humans are full of it, because it's in the water we drink, the food we eat, and the air that we breathe. Now, this episode has come under fire from some very silly people, in my opinion, for Series 12 supposedly having another environmental message after Orphan 55. Now, never mind the fact that plastic pollution is a completely separate thing from climate change, but I actually think that this episode's approach to topical storytelling is way more effective than Orphan 55, at least in this context. See, in Praxeus, there there isn't a speech where the Doctor talks about the evil of plastic or tries to destroy all the plastic on Earth to save the day. Rather, plastic washing up on otherwise beautiful shorelines, plastic gathering where the tides go in the Indian Ocean, and birds' stomachs being full of plastic serves as a background detail. It's not like the plastic is alien. The plastic on Earth is something that the alien threat uses and takes advantage of. It reminds me of Gridlock from Series 3. Yeah, there's subtext about car pollution and traffic congestion, but that's not the main threat. The actual threat of the story comes from the Macra, which take advantage of that pollution. Praxeus takes a human problem, a human element, and builds a sci-fi story on top of that. It's not preachy, it's not lecturing, and I think people saying otherwise have insane standards, where literally just something existing in a story as a plot point is considered preachy. Ah, the ever-shifting goalposts of the fandom. Not to mention the reveal that Suki is an alien whose kind came to Earth to use it as like a petri dish to experiment on and try and find a cure for Praxeus is a great twist, because Suki and whoever she came to Earth with aren't human, which means that they're testing humans infected with Praxeus like lab rats. Random point, but my favourite work of fiction ever is H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds. It's like my favourite story ever. I've read the book like 20 times, I read it at least once a year. And that story was inspired from British colonialism, and how Wells imagined humans being invaded by a technically advanced foreign power, much like the colonies that England invaded. The idea that Earth can be used in such a selfish, frivolous way is not only great big idea sci-fi, it's pretty scary. Or at least I think it's scary. It makes you think of your own place in the universe. But it's not all doom and gloom. Pete Mattig's brilliant dialogue from Kablam is on full display here. And I think this line, this follow-up from a previous gag, is the funniest line of the entire Chibnall era so far.
Glad you're safe. How are you feeling?
Terrible.
Yeah, you look it. I hadn't factored you into this. Focus too much on that cat.
Listen, humor is subjective, but that line, it has me laughing just thinking about it. The script also works structurally well. Scenes lead well into the next, the script always has forward momentum, and the touch of having the Doctor just appear and show up without announcement or establishing shot not only keeps the pace up, but also sells the Doctor as some omnipresent entity. Continent hopping means nothing to a Time Lord. If anything, the story might move a bit too quickly. I've noticed this recently with the Chibnall era, where there's hardly any quiet time. Oh, there are some slow scenes sometimes, but it's very rare for the story to just stop for 10 to 15 seconds to let the atmosphere sit or let tension build. Like when the birds attack the Madagascar scientific facility.
We need to get out of here.
Have they gone?
Now, I really feel like there should have been a good 10 more seconds of anticipation. Really earn that jump scare. And then, when the birds start attacking and the gang make their way to the TARDIS, there's this awesome shot of all of the birds just flying past the TARDIS on a beach like a force of nature. But I would have loved to have seen something akin to this Forbidden Planet t-shirt design. This image, paying homage to Alfred Hitchcock's The Birds, feels like it should have been in the episode itself, not on a t-shirt. Series 11 and Series 12 have been given the benefit of an extra 5 minutes of runtime, and while it's often used to give us more plot or character building, I wish it was used to build up atmosphere, mood, and tension. Now, that's not to say that Praxeus doesn't have those things, but I think this story could have benefited from more of it. Like, get rid of the opening and closing narration and give us some mood shots in its place. Like, why does Praxeus even have this narration?
Planet Earth, early in the third decade of the 21st century. Population, 7 billion. 7 billion lives, separate and connected.
Get on with it!
Yes! Get on with it!
Anyway, at least this episode does use its 50-minute runtime to give us some nice character work. Suki works well to give us the bait and switch, and when it comes to fleshing out the cast proper, Jake and Adam really take the cake here. In terms of the relationship itself, it's not exactly exploring new ground, but you get to know these two and their dynamic quite quickly, despite one of them being on the verge of death for most of the runtime. Warren Brown as Jake gives a very grounded performance, and one of my favourite scenes of the episode is the one he shares with Graham on the Madagascar beach.
Yeah, he's a lucky, lucky bloke.
My husband is an astronaut. Do you have any idea how hard it is being married to somebody that impressive?
Not only is that hugely relatable, but Graham's silent reaction to that just speaks volumes. I don't even think Grace has been mentioned in Series 12 at all, but this scene shows that she is still hanging over Graham as something he's still coming to terms with. If there's one issue with Jake's arc, it's that we really don't get to know enough of his backstory to make the lesson he has to learn really land.
Stop dodging life. Please.
Okay, so he's an ex-copper who doesn't do emotion, who feels like he's living in the shadow of his husband, and I don't quite see how him dodging and avoiding life really fits into that. Now, don't get me wrong, it's a good lesson to learn. I just think it needed fleshing out more. While Praxeus might not be quite overflowing with characters, it does still feel like the script is a little bit too busy with locations and characters. Gabriella is a decent addition, but outside of meeting Ryan, she really doesn't have anything to do other than just be along for the ride with Yaz and offer incredible insight like this.
We're at the bottom of the Indian Ocean.
Thanks for that contribution. Also, I think going from the Peru campsite to the abandoned hospital to meet up with Jamila was a bit extraneous. There's no reason they couldn't have just found Jamila nearby, and the abandoned hospital just raises a lot of questions, like, what happened? Was Jamila one of many others who were infected and she destroyed the entire hospital population? If that's the case, why isn't that said or mentioned? In fact, it's this line of dialogue which makes me doubt it.
Two identical deaths on two different continents. It's even more dangerous than I thought.
See, she only mentions two identical deaths on two different continents, not an entire hospital that might have been wiped out. Yeah, maybe there's a throwaway line that I missed that explains it, but I don't think it really justifies the change in location and the several minutes of screen time that this hospital setting gets. Which reminds me, why did the aliens experimenting on Praxeus have separate bases in Madagascar, Hong Kong, and the Indian Ocean? The episode moves along quickly enough for you to not really ask these questions, but why is their equipment so far apart? I also think Aramu is really underused here. He stays outside to keep an eye on the birds, gets killed by them, and I don't think a single character even cares or references his death.
Of he died peacefully in his sleep, isn't it?
But despite all of these elements, the episode moves along at a really good clip, to the extent that when the Doctor and everyone were at the bottom of the Indian Ocean to bring us to the third act, I was worried that they were leaving the guaranteed reveal of the Sea Devils way too last minute, but then it turned out that it wasn't the Sea Devils at all, and I could just enjoy the climax without my expectations getting in the way, especially on a second viewing. I also don't want to keep comparing this to Orphan 55, but I really like how the Doctor was able to save Jake at the end. The bury your gaze trope is really played out and often spiteful, so giving these two husbands a happy ending was great, though I'm sure that Adric is watching from the afterlife in sheer disgust. But yeah, the ending of Orphan 55, when the Doctor doesn't even attempt to go back and save Kane and Bella, despite being in a space-time machine and knowing where they are, felt so out of place and out of character. But Praxeus was able to deliver that optimistic ending that the Doctor should always be fighting for. Overall though, I really enjoyed Praxeus. It has the wit and the energy that made Kablam so memorable last series, but with a much more satisfying and cohesive ending. It might be a bit busy and in too much of a rush at times, but it holds together, and it gives us a story that's not overbearing with its social commentary, but using a uniquely 21st century human issue and building an engaging sci-fi narrative on top of it. Jodie is great here, the companions actually feel useful and present in the narrative, especially Yaz. The rest of the cast are strong, and there's some really great shots and direction from Spyfall director Jamie Magnus Stone. And alongside Nikola Tesla's Night of Terror, Praxeus is the standout of the series so far. I wish I had a funny way to end this review. Heck, let's just play the Birdemic footage again.
Shit, here they come!
Hey folks, sorry that this review is a day or two late. Me and my partner just adopted a second kitten, so we've been spending a lot of time settling her in. There's some photos and videos on my social medias and everything, but anyway, I've got a couple of non-review videos in the pipeline right now, and if you want to get early access to that content and even be involved in it, along with just generally keeping the lights on, then you can become a patron of Mr. TARDIS Reviews, like these lovely people whose names are on screen right now. I would like to give a particular shout out to Anne Neubauer, Callum Baird, Charlotte Pierce Cornish, Dean Jones, EVG Express, Joseph Adams, Katie Maxwell, Luna Day, Matthew Perry, Palix, Paul Warbeck, Rebecca Hill, Shazeb Mangi, The Brit Sniper, Vibraphonic Marxism, William Jacks, and Zachary Taylor, aka Mario Fanboy 15. And if you can't support me on Patreon, that's absolutely fine. You can support this channel in other ways, like leaving a comment or liking this video to appeal to the almighty YouTube algorithm. Thanks so much for watching this review, and I'll see you next week for Can You Hear Me? I'll see you all next time.